we had no choice. They jumped on us and without provocation, and so when they bombed Pearl Harbor, that was all. There was no question about going into war against Germany.
We were tired of what the Germans had been doing to the world. They were pretty bad during World War II. They did a lot of things they should not have done.
I think the biggest majority of the American people was mad, and they, let's get this over with. And they did what they had to do, willingly.
I guess the generation I came through was pretty tough. I think it was pretty tough. And whatever happened, you just took it, done the best you could, and survived and went on.
The future of America was at stake, but actually we more or less were just thinking about supporting our troops and winning the war and bringing them back home.
I mean, you're fighting for freedom everywhere, but basically we're fighting for our country.
If we hadn't have fought that war, if we hadn't have won, our families would have been next. War is sometimes a necessity. We don't like it. And you don't, people say they hate war. You don't hate war until you fought one. And then until you fought two, you don't really hate war.
We weren't ready for it. We weren't prepared. So we did a tremendous job getting prepared and then entering into it and then winning it.
There wasn't any doubt when I looked around at the country. It was solid, virtually undamaged from the war. And then looking at what Europe was, how could it come out any different than it did? It just couldn't. We were unbeatable.
Young Americans were not thinking about war in 1941, but on a tragic December day, all that changed. Soon, young people from across the United States, including more than 268,000 from Oklahoma, were propelled into the largest and deadliest conflict in the history of the world, World War II. Courageously accepting the challenge of a lifetime, their selfless sacrifice defined us as a people and set the course for the rest of the 20th century and beyond. This program is a tribute to all those who served. These are some of their stories. Life was good in Hawaii in the early 1940s for American sailors like Paul Goodyear. He and his shipmates aboard the USS Oklahoma performed maneuvers and maintenance during the week, took liberty on the weekend, and enjoyed the laid-back island atmosphere. For farm boys like Goodyear, it was paradise. The war in Europe was half a world away.
It was a good ship. The officers were honest and fair, and it was considered a happy ship. It was a good ship to have duty on.
In just 11 and a half minutes on December 7th, 1941, at Pearl Harbor, everything changed.
Like any other Sunday morning in Hawaii, beautiful sunshiny day, and we had come in on Friday night, and I'd had liberty on Saturday, and I had the 8 to 12 watch on Sunday morning, and we saw a line of planes, maybe 6, 8, 10, I really don't know how long it was, but they were flying from our starboard to our port side about a mile ahead of us. And as they got almost ahead of us, the first plane dropped a bomb. A minute later, the second plane dropped a bomb. Well, as the third plane dropped his bomb, there was a miniature ball of firelight. And I had a pair of 750 binoculars, and I put them to my eyes, and that meatball hit me right in the eye. And right then, we knew it was the Japanese.
A few minutes later, another line of planes launched a second attack. And Goodyear plunged into the oily waters.
When I dropped off, the ship was still 90 degrees. So I just stepped off and dropped in the water and swam to the Maryland. This is only a 50-foot drop, so. And I, at that time, I didn't even worry. If it had been 500 feet, I think I would have jumped.
With dozens of heads bobbing around him and bullets hitting above him, Goodyear swam to the safety of the Maryland and watched the Oklahoma's mast roll over into the water. 429 sailors and Marines perished in the watery tomb that was the Oklahoma, the second greatest number of casualties suffered by the 9 battleships in the harbor.
The Japanese have attacked Pearl Harbor, Hawaii by air, President Roosevelt has just announced. The attack also was made on all naval and military activities on the principal island of Oahu.
I knew it was a war, and I knew I was going to be there for the rest of it if I lived.
We interrupt this broadcast to bring you this important bulletin from the United Press. Flash, Washington. The White House announces Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor.
The attack on Pearl Harbor stunned the nation and left America no choice but to enter the war.
The facts of yesterday and today speak for themselves. I believe that I interpret the will of the Congress and of the people when I assert that we will not only defend ourselves to the uttermost, but will make it very certain that this form of treachery shall never again endanger us.
Goodyear served out World War II aboard other ships in the South Pacific, but he returned to Pearl Harbor and the Oklahoma 2 years later. The ship had been righted, and armed with a flashlight, Goodyear went back into the pitch-black crew compartment to look for 2 items he had left, a ring intended for a lady friend and $130.
It was just one big room, and we all shared the same area. And when I saw those bones down there, I knew very well that I knew a lot of those kids. Of course, there was no identification because there was just piles of bones and they were just commingled all over the place. That's as far as I could go. I couldn't go any farther, so I never did get the ring or the $130. So. But I got out alive. That was the main thing.
I just knew that we needed to get into the Army, and they needed chaplains, and that our men needed guidance during that time. And I just felt like that's what God wanted me to do.
Charles Richmond was a minister and teacher, married and exempt from the draft. But when war broke out, he wanted to be involved. Rather than stay home and pray for the soldiers, he preferred to join the Army and pray with them.
As a young man, I was taught you're not supposed to fight. Then when the war broke out, I had to decide, what does the Bible say about it? What does my religion say about it? And I thought, well, some things are worth fighting for. The Bible says, live peaceably as much as within you is with all people, as much as it be possible. Sometimes it isn't possible.
After limited military training, the Army sent Richmond into the China-Burma-India Theater, where he stayed for 2.5 years.
The Japanese had attacked China, and they had taken all the port cities of China. All the port cities had taken. So where they, where for the Chinese Army, they could not get any supplies in. So we had our mission was to attack and clear the Japanese from Burma. At the same time, build a road across where we could haul supplies. At the same time, we were building a oil pipeline to where we could get gas and oil open. So we were building a road and everything in order to get our people supply, get Chinese supplied in China. We slept under mosquito nets, always. We had snakes. We even had a tiger break into one of our tents and maul up a boy's shoulder. He recovered, but we had to send him home. But talk about psychological problems, he had them.
Anytime a soldier had a problem, he would take it to the chaplain.
He delivered death messages, Dear John letters, and if they didn't get letters from home, we'd check up on them. And if a boy was not writing home, many times the mother or someone would write and ask the chaplain to be sure that they wrote message. Well, we saw that they wrote message.
Chaplains could not carry a weapon, but Richmond visited the front lines every 2 weeks to conduct services, funerals, and minister to his men.
I determined before we were married that I was not going to let fear control my life. I'm going to control the fear and do what I can with it. So when I was up front where I needed to, I'd have somebody with me that had a gun. But if that time was going to come, if God had said my time was come, okay. Otherwise, I'm going to go ahead and do what needs to be done, because this is more important than my life.
Richmond survived World War II and the Korean War later. He's proud of what his generation accomplished.
When you're in a position that we were in, you just throw your shoulders back, stand tall, depend on the Lord, and do what needs to be done. My family, I have protected. And my friends, I have protected. My nation, I have protected. And I am proud and happy that I have done that for my people. I feel like an American and a Christian American.